This evening on The Rock Newman Show, I talk about the power and presence of social media with social and digital media guru Danielle Ricks and Howard University School of Communications Chair and Professor Yannick Rice Lamb. We'll discuss how social media is shaping present-day society, and we'll also explore social media strategies that best serve the Black community. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Between Donald Trump's Twitter tantrums, silly Snapchat filters, and the explosion of Black Twitter, social media lies at the core of the way people communicate across the world, with powers that can be used for good and evil. Healthy social media engagement is critical. Joining me now to discuss savvy social media strategies, the impact of Donald Trump's Twitter rants, and how social media can advance Black causes is Yannick Rice Lamb, Associate Professor and Chair for the Kathy Hughes School of Communications at Howard University, and Danielle Ricks, Digital and Social Media Strategist. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show, ladies.
Thank you guys so much for being here.
Thank you for having us.
We're talking about the social media in the setup here. I have a book that sits before me that you wrote, Professor Lamb. It's called Rise and Fly, The Tales and Mostly True...
Tall Tales and Mostly True Rules of BidWiz.
And Mostly True Rules of BidWiz. Now, whereas we talk about social media, it really struck me that there was a form of communication that goes on during the times when folks play BidWiz that gives an elevated bravado, strategy, communication that is very indigenous to the Black, for the most part, to the Black community. Tell me this, how did it come about to be such a popular social exercise for Black folks?
Well, it dates back pretty far, and some of the Pullman porters were playing it on the trains.
Mm-hmm.
And then we also play it at parties, at family reunions,
yeah,
and all sorts of things like that, and in schools too. So when people at college campuses, when they were supposed to be in classes, they were in the student center playing BidWiz or playing spades,
yeah,
and fish fries, late night things. Talk about people making people wait on the porch to come back in after they lost the game.
Uh-huh.
So I think that a lot of times our personality comes out in there and trash talking and playing the dozens,
mm-hmm,
in terms of, particularly if you're winning.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, sometimes things people put on the table to warn people against losing or,
yeah,
against winning,
yeah,
if they're the opposing team.
Uh-huh.
And then you know, all the people who like stick the winning card on their forehead.
Uh-huh. That's right.
Kind of
taunt
you, slap
this
it up
what,
there.
This, yeah, is what's going to set you.
This is going to set you. This is how we're sending you to Boston.
You know, I have found it to be one of the most fun things. I once was doing a radio show every evening, and it was a sports show, and it was a slow day, and just wasn't anything exciting happening. And I didn't know what I was going to talk about when the light came on at 6 o'clock. And so I started that particular broadcast by saying, unless you really are born in Washington, D.C., you really don't know how to play BidWiz. And we had a light, we had a console that had about 12 lights on it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm really thinking I'm in Death Valley today, not knowing what I am going to talk about. Those lights lit up and stayed lit for the entire 2 hours that I was on, prompting me to set up a BidWiz tournament at the Blackburn Center,
wow,
at Howard University. It was supposed to be called a punch out, and it was called,
yeah,
a punch out.
It's because, still called a punch out.
Yeah, because student punched out of school over at the Blackburn Center playing BidWiz. It's something that's very popular and very fun.
Yeah, it will draw a lot of people to you when you want to play, yes. Or as soon as you mention it.
And so let me go to you, yeah. Danielle, as we talk about this world of social media and communicating. Mm-hmm. It seems as if it offers the best and the worst of our ability to communicate.
Absolutely. So you have the worst, which are people that can sit behind the keyboard and remain anonymous and spew hate and vile. Yeah. And then you have the best, and people who can use this as a medium to promote their craft, but also to advocate for causes that they find dear to themselves. So it brings out many different personalities. Mm-hmm. And then there are some people who use this medium for an alter ego. So it's not necessarily who they really are in person, mm-hmm. but it's who they are online. And we have to weed through some of that communication to determine what is real and what is alternative facts and what's actually real.
Yeah. And as a professor here at the university, I really would like to get a snapshot. Not Snapchat. But
although that's very popular.
Oh, I hear, but Lord knows that's, I ain't got there yet. I would like to hear your sort of professorial take on this world of social media that really is, you know, it's within the last, what, eight to 10 years that it has exploded exponentially. Mm-hmm. What do you, one, your observation just about the phenomena, and I certainly want to get into later.
Okay.
I want to get into, you were a writer, for example, at the New York Times for 8 years and then the magazine for two. We want to go back and compare and contrast. But for right now, what do you communicate to your students?
One of the first things we communicate to them is to be careful, because a lot of times people, it is a conversation in social media and cyberspace, but you're having a conversation with the world, with the universe. Mm-hmm. So to be careful about what you put on there, and also thinking about how it's going to follow you, particularly in terms of employment. So our students know how to use it a lot socially. We try to show them how to use it professionally as well. So to use it with their stories, the ones who are going in public relations and other areas, how to use that for some of the clients that they'll have.
Yeah.
And to, you know, to be careful with it and to build their brand and to showcase themselves in the best light.
I want to piggyback on that just a little bit and say that for, you know, coming out of the School of Communications at Howard University and having my career, 25 years in television broadcasting, I was a storyteller, and that's how I connect the dots in terms of what I did before and what I do now in social media as a storyteller. And I like to tell students that I didn't have the opportunity to produce a TV show, right? And if they want to be producers, then they need to produce. If you want to be a writer, you should be writing and producing a blog. If you want to be a television producer or on-air talent, you should have a YouTube channel. If you want to be a sportscaster and you're at Howard University, then I fully expect you to go and interview the sports athletes and start a blog or have a YouTube channel or put it on Snapchat or put it on Facebook. They have an opportunity to be. While they're getting their credentials and while they're learning the traditional way, they have an opportunity to actually create. But again, their digital footprint is very important, because while they're doing this professionally and they're building their professional portfolio, people are also looking at what they're doing socially. And big brands, big corporations have HR people that go out and look for these people's Facebook pages. And when it's between Becky and LaQuisha, and Becky has all of her professional things in her Facebook page and her Snapchat, and LaQuisha's turned up, and they may have the same exact credentials, but the corporation is going to pick someone who looks closer to their values and who speaks closer to their values. So I often tell these students, you think you're doing stuff on Snapchat and it's going to disappear, but it lives somewhere, and someone can find it, and this could potentially come back and haunt you.
And even if you take it down, it's still findable, too. So we tell them all the same thing, too, in terms of, and a lot of our students are using it in a lot of different ways to tell different stories and to build, also in terms of building their digital portfolio online and incorporating it into that.
As a lifelong proponent of the telephone, I really want to have you both to weigh in on the psychology of communicating digitally. And so, you know, with all the various forms, you know, Snapchat, Twitter, when I see, there are some people now I find who really seem that it is a strain. They do everything they can to avoid one-to-one voice communication. It drives me crazy. And it seems to me that there is a depersonalizing of relationships. And I want to, if you...
There is some of that, particularly if people, you know, if they're young and they grew up and only using their phone, primarily using their phone, and mm-hmm. and sometimes they feel it's more invasive to pick up the phone and call someone than to send them a text.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes you see that, particularly between different age groups. Some people prefer to use a phone, as you mentioned. Some people prefer to get a text. Some people prefer to send an email. And you kind of have to think about what works best for the people you're dealing with, and also how the messages are coming across too. Because sometimes when people are texting or emailing, it may sound like an argument, and it's not.
Yeah.
So people think you're being serious, you're being mean, and you're being lighthearted. And so sometimes people add emojis and different things to kind of let people know that they aren't. So you have to think about how you're communicating. And also in your business communications, a lot of times with the shortcuts and the shorthand, that follows people across the board. They get so used to doing it that they don't filter themselves and make sure they're doing that primarily with friends.
Daniel?
So I'm completely guilty of being in the younger demographic. I do not like talking on the phone.
Uh-huh.
Even on my voicemail, on my phone, it says the best way to reach me is to text me. Uh-huh. So I don't know if I was transported back in time, but I like the instant messaging. I like to be able, now, I like text messaging. Because I'm on so many different social platforms, I don't like people to send me an inbox message on Facebook. Please stop sending me inbox messages on Facebook. Or on Twitter or Snapchat. Oftentimes, the ding's going off on my phone, and I don't know where the message is coming from.
Uh-huh.
So I would prefer people email me or text me. Mm-hmm. And then if we need to have a longer conversation, we will. However, in the business, you do have to pick up the phone and call your clients. Now, off the flip side of that is I'm in the middle of working with a client right now in Los Angeles. We're doing a huge festival in LA. He's getting a lot of emails from different sponsors and artists and managers. So he and I text each other back and forth, because if I need something right away, that's the easiest way to get them. What I think we have to really figure out is, and this is whether or not you're using digital or not, what is that relationship with your boss or your coworker or your partner? How do they like to communicate? Whenever I'm working with the team, the very first thing that I want to find out with is the person who hired me, how do you like to communicate? And then I tell my team how I like to communicate. And I think if we can get that out of the way up front, then we'll be better at overall communications and being able to serve people where they're at. But I am guilty of being one of those people that does not like to pick up the phone.
Let me ask you something.
I use all of the above.
Let me ask you. There was a point when you didn't have social media, and your way of communicating had to be the phone. So what is it that causes you now to prefer not to pick up the phone?
I want to get to the point. And anyone who's ever worked with me will know that's the biggest thing. What are you trying to communicate to me? I just want to get to the bottom line. And oftentimes when you get on the phone, especially if it's someone you haven't spoken to in a long time, well, hey, how you doing? How the kids? How everything's going? I heard your health wasn't. How's that? Okay, did you see the last? And I just want you to get to the point. And then when we have a conversation, I'd like to map up an hour so we can have a long conversation and we can talk. And if it's business, then I really need you to just get to the point so that I can continue to service you if you're my client, or I can continue to provide whatever you need in terms of information for me. So I like the quickness of it and being able to get to the bottom line.
I think just using the phone kind of forces you to be concise, because some people don't want to, you know, text a really, really long message, although a lot of people do that. So I think, like she said, and I said earlier, knowing who you're communicating with, so you're communicating to them in the most effective way.
It drives my friends and my friends crazy, by the way. Absolutely crazy. And when I do pick up the phone, they're completely shocked.
Children. I see, go to dinner. There's a family of five, mom, dad, three kids. The kids are here, and mom and dad are kind of looking and seeing lost, I want to say, put the damn devices down and have communication and have some family time. So with that kind of obsessiveness to something small in your hand, what do we project?
I think that's cutting across ages too, because sometimes the parents they have them in their hands as well too. But you do have to know when to put them down, because there's a time and place for them. Although we like to have them near us because we're so used to it now. It's like they're tethered to us at this point. But if you're like in a family setting, or if you're texting someone who's in the same room with you, then you just need to say something to that person, you know. So I do think we need to take a break. And sometimes people do have tech breaks from TV, from their phones, from different devices, so that they can engage more with other people.
So you said tethered to. And I part of what I want to explore here is, has it been a conscious effort by the Apple, the IT people, to addict us to these devices as the cigarette companies addicted us to their product?
Well, Apple wanted to do that. I mean, they wanted us to like all of their products and to kind of feel like we had to have it and wanted it first. So that was a little bit part of their corporate strategy in the beginning.
I don't know that they necessarily psychologically thought that we were going, that it was in their business plan to get us psychologically addicted. I don't know that anyone could have predicted how addicted we would become. But it has become our everything. Mm-hmm. It is our music device, our clock, our watch, our television, our daykeeper, our communication device. It is everything rolled into one. And there are psychological studies coming out now that are talking about that addiction factor. Mm-hmm. There are studies that are talking about what happens to toddlers who spend too much time on an iPad, what's happening to their cognitive skills. We are already seeing that a lot of young people are not able to put two and two together and be able to do cognitive thinking, because everything is there for them. I can Google it. Mm-hmm. So I don't really have to think through a problem because I can Google the problem. Mm-hmm. We're about a decade away from being able to understand fully what these devices do to us. Mm-hmm. But to your scenario on the table, I mean, I'm the person who, when I go out, I'm going to say to everybody, you got to give me a minute, I'm going to take a photo. Mm-hmm. And I have some older family members like, what do you need to take a picture of your food for? Yeah. They completely do not understand.
That's right.
But what they don't understand is oftentimes when I am taking foods and I'm giving props to a restaurant or a hotel, that looks good for my portfolio and my brand because I do a lot of travel blogging and I do a lot of blogging about food. I'm a foodie. Mm-hmm. So it makes sense for me to take photos and give credit where credit is due to great restaurants. Mm-hmm. But it's hard to describe that to people when you're sitting out at a table with five. Well, you know, this is my brand. I'm doing this with the Danielle Ricks brand. Give me a minute. I'm going to take this photo. Mm-hmm. But most people know when they go with me, you don't pick up your fork until I set it just right. Uh-huh. And it's irritating, right? And then I get my picture. Then you put your phone face down, and then we have to spend some quality time together. Mm-hmm. But I've been out with guys on their phone watching sports games, and they're keeping up with the scores, and you know, we're out on a date, and you're still watching to see what the score is. And I'm like, dude, put your phone down. Mm-hmm. So it's intrusive into our lives as much as we allow it to be intrusive into our lives. Mm-hmm. But as we, adults move through our community and we figure out what's happening in our community, we also are going to have to figure out what's happening with our young people and their addiction to these devices.
You just gave this woman at my house that's watching this show right now such a license. We call her Spielie, as in Spielberg, because every plate of greens, she must gather it properly and make sure that the orange slice is just right there.
It has to be perfect. You do it for the gram. We do this for the Instagram. We do it for the gram.
And she is equally critical of me because she calls my cell phone my mistress. It is with me when she is not. And when she is with me.
Right.
Donald Trump.
Oh.
Donald J. Trump. He is by far the most prolific exposer marketer, if you will, mm-hmm. of Twitter. Mm-hmm. While he's the biggest proponent, the person who people, when you think of him, you think of Twitter, because of some of the content that has been so judged as uninformed and ignorant, you hear comments about his use of Twitter that span the spectrum. Mm-hmm. Your observations?
I think he's on it too much. I mean, one of the things is I think that he's missing an opportunity to use some of the, you know, all the different areas, different platforms that he can use to send his message. Because once he puts it out there, it's being interpreted and lives out there probably longer. And some when he makes a mistake or says something that's inappropriate or crazy or it's not true, I think it lasts longer. And if he had more things out there, it would push it down in the news cycle or just push it down in people's minds. Also, he's missing a segment. While there are a lot of people on Twitter, not everybody is on Twitter, so he's missing some people. So those people who see those tweets, they're seeing them from somebody else's and through their lens when they're adding what else he said to it. They're not getting it unfiltered as he's expecting it to be given. And I guess as presidents, we don't expect them to make their initial announcements on Twitter because that's not what everybody is used to. Obama used social media effectively when he ran for president the first time around, and that was probably one of the biggest uses we've seen of social media in a presidential campaign. Mm-hmm. And he used it a lot while he was in office too, but he also used everything else that's out there. Mm-hmm. He used YouTube, he had digital interviews, he used a lot of different things, but it wasn't the only place where he was living, so his message was in different places and he could reach people where they were. Mm-hmm.
Never in my lifetime did I think that I would see a tweet on a news show, that they would actually take a tweet and that would get national news. President Obama had an amazing digital strategy mm-hmm. and an amazing digital team. Mm-hmm. And the way they use Twitter and Facebook and LinkedIn, I'm LinkedIn friends with the President of the United States. Who does that? Like, that was amazing. Mm-hmm. His speeches, President Obama's speeches, were done in 140 characters. Mm-hmm. So that if you wanted to tweet his speech, they broke it up so mm-hmm. that you could quote him mm-hmm. as you were following along and live tweeting. Mm-hmm. What Donald Trump is doing is a very knee-jerk, visceral reaction to something that's happening. And I tell my clients all the time, do not respond in social media to something that's boiling up inside of you. Let's have a conversation. Let's get strategic about what that message is. They can't get that phone out of his hand. Yeah. So he is responding with something that had he thought about it a little longer, he may not have mm-hmm. even put it out there. Mm-hmm. And though it is just one platform, the media is elevating that yes. platform so yeah. that everybody gets to hear it. Mm. But it's a knee-jerk reaction with some of the things that he's saying. And then he has to go back and defend what he says. I believe he believes what he's saying, but everyone doesn't maybe need to know what you're thinking. Mm. However, on the other side, as somebody who's part of the resistance, I am completely open to him continuing to tweet because yeah. I want to know what he's thinking. Yeah. And it's unfiltered, so unfiltered that they can't control the narrative anymore and they can't control the story. So it's uncomfortable for the people in his media department mm-hmm. and his communications department because he goes juxtaposed to what they've maybe just said in a press conference mm-hmm. or are just about to say in a press conference. Mm-hmm. He'll go just opposite of what he's saying. So at this point, his approval rating has gone down because we don't believe that we can actually take what he says to heart. Anytime your political analyst or your communications director comes on and says, well, don't believe what he tweets. What does that mean?
And then he tells you to believe what he
tells you. And then he tells you to be like, so now our faith in our commander in chief has gone down because we don't know what's true anymore. Mm-hmm. We don't know if what he's actually communicating is true or the spin doctors who are giving us the spin on what he's tweeting at a press conference is true. Mm-hmm. And that leaves the American public very vulnerable.
And he's doing what other people, what he accused other people of doing in terms of taking things out of context too when he tweets it.
Yeah. I want to ask you, as I mentioned, you are a writer for the New York Times, writer for the New York Times Magazine. I want to ask you if you would sort of give your editorial reaction to the president that is behaving in a way that it is becoming commonplace for pundits to talk about how his handlers are trying to make sure when he was in the Middle East, trying to make sure that he was in these ceremonies that was making him feel good and important, and making sure that he was participating in events where he would have, where he would be, there would be lavish praise heaped upon him so that they could keep him occupied away from watching TV. Because if he watched TV, they knew that he didn't have the impulse control to not tweet something. So in a big picture, that sounds like you're talking about an 8-year-old, but he happens to be the president of the United States. What do we have here?
We have a very impulsive person who does need to be controlled. And that, it, as you liken it to like controlling a child, and you redirect their attention so you can keep them out, away from doing certain things. Mm-hmm. So that's what they're trying to do. And they look very uncomfortable sometimes when they're trying to defend what he has said or what he's done. And so I imagine that's a very hard job to have. I wouldn't want to have that mm-hmm. job, to kind of have to try to manage what he's saying, manage his activities, and trying to keep him on message, because he won't stay on message. He has his own message, and he veers off of that.
And really, the question that I am asking mm-hmm. is, there is no greater example for people and for children mm-hmm. to observe than the president. So with these young malleable minds observing this, I just kind of want to see if we can draw a connection to what that is doing, what you think that might be doing.
I think it's more important than ever for parents and for teachers and other people working with young children and teenagers and young adults to kind of, you know, filter that and interpret what they're seeing. Just with everything else that's going on in the world too, but particularly with how the president handles things or some of the things that he's saying, that that they understand what's going on, that they are not misled by it, and that they don't repeat some of it too, mm-hmm. In terms of some of the behavior and that kind of thing.
Danielle, mm-hmm. you mentioned how adroitly Obama used mm-hmm. social media, and by and large, I think your comment reflected sort of the responsible way.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned he and his team.
Right.
Is it your sense that the current person at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue does not have a team that has any impact on him?
It's the last part of what you said, that doesn't have any impact on him. If there is a team, they do not have an impact on him. If there's a team in place, he's not listening to them. Never would we, as media consultants, say to our client to go ad hoc, take your phone and just tweet whatever you feel like tweeting. I would never recommend that to anyone, to be strategic about what you're tweeting, what your Facebook posts. Everything should be strategic. There should be an overall goal. What is the overall goal? What is the overall story that you want to tell? And then what channels are we going to use to get that story out? Mm-hmm. And then how do we trickle down that information via the various channels? And never would I actually put a device in a client's hand and say, go out on your own and just go ahead and tweet. And good luck to you. Hope that works out. Never would I do that. And so he's going to have the president would have the best of the best in the digital space, right? The best mm-hmm. of the best teams. If a team has been hired, he's not listening to them, and I don't know if they're still getting a paycheck, but they've got to be extremely frustrated at this point, because nothing that he's doing is matching an overall communication strategy. And that's where it starts. It starts with the goal of, why are you using social media in the first place? What tools are you going to use to get your message mm-hmm. out? What's the story that you're going to tell? And then how do we get that out to the masses? He's not following the formula. He's off script. He's completely off script.
You have some very cogent points about developing a social media mm-hmm. strategy. I mm-hmm. want to get to that in just a moment.
Sure.
But I'd like to see if you would wade into this sort of murky water that, you know, I'm looking at with a president who is the lead, supposed to be the lead example of what is best about the country. The imagery that young kids see of him and how he behaves on these platforms that they have total access to.
Yeah, I agree that families have to get involved. We've got to use this opportunity to have conversations with these young people to talk about what's appropriate and inappropriate behavior from the leader of our country who is setting an example, that we have to have some hard conversations about how to use these platforms, and again, what's appropriate and inappropriate. We can't just allow not just the president, but any of their so-called idols or any of their so-called mentors that are out here using these platforms in a way that would go against the values of the family. And each family has their own values, right? Each family has their own culture and their own set of values. And the parents have got to get involved to be able to say, well, you know, dear, what you saw on Twitter today goes against how we believe X, Y, and Z. We as a community are going to have to take more control over how we communicate. And, you know, thank goodness for the New York Times and the Washington Post and the Associated Press. I re-upped all of my subscriptions and Vanity Fair and Teen Vogue. They're doing some amazing journalistic reporting. They're doing some amazing op-eds. And it's now time for us to talk to our kids about
it. They're doing that?
They are, yeah.
I thought they were all fake news.
Oh, yeah. No. And that's the conversation we have to have with these kids. Yeah. What is fake news? Yeah. And how does the Washington Post vet a story? How does the New York Times vet a story? What does it mean when they say unnamed sources? What does that mean? How do you get to print? Coming from journalism, it takes a lot to get a story to print. And these children need to understand traditional media as we move into social media, that this is not fake news. Like they've talked to several people and vetted several people before they go to print. And so we have to talk to our kids about what that process is like and what's the difference between fake news and real news and help them figure out what fake news
Which
is.
Which really leads me into something I want to talk to you about as a professor in the School of Communications. You have kids who are coming through who obviously want to be writers. They want to be producers. They want to do film. So as we talk about this backdrop of social media, what is it that your department, that your classes, for example, offer them in preparation for those pursuits?
Well, one of the things we talk to them is kind of also understanding the history of our images and how we've been portrayed in the past and their responsibility and role and how we're portrayed now and in the future so that they take personal responsibility for how they're doing that. And then also how they integrate social media into that.
Stop, because I think that's very important. Ultimately, the genesis of me sitting at this table was looking at historic way that we have been portrayed and wanting to have an impact on that, changing that narrative. So if you could give me some examples about what you think about when you say historically how we've been portrayed and what their responsibility is.
Well, with our film program, for example, they look at Birth of a Nation and things that have come, you know, since that time. And then we have a big emphasis on independent filmmaking. And so they look at films that were produced by us, films that were produced by others, compare how they were portrayed, and talk about some of the things that they can do in their own work in the future. Same with the journalists, same with people in, you know, audio production or television production. So that we, you know, they learn the history, so they know what the past was, and they see what's the present day images too. We get them to think about what they're seeing and what they can do about it. And then also what they're portraying in their work. So that, and also encouraging them, just because they're the HBCU, to make sure that they're also being diverse in some of the things that they're doing. But telling our own stories, but also being able to tell the stories of others as well.
Oh, there's so many reasons why I love Howard University. Danielle, you've developed a social media marketing strategy.
Yes.
There are many tenets to that.
Yes.
I'd like to the content strategies that you've developed, I'd like to maybe talk about a couple of those,
sure.
Which are the sort of the foundation. You know, you can't build a house without having the foundation.
Right.
So if we could, you know, sort of start where the foundation exists.
Sure. The very first one is to have a plan, and I know that that sounds very simple, but it is actually to have a strategic plan. And the first question I would ask a client is, well, why do you want to use social media? So you want to have a goal. Why are you in this space in the first place? And it's not because it's the new shiny toy. Oh, Snapchat, everybody's using it, let me use it. That's not really the plan. The plan is I either want to promote something, I want to encourage awareness about something, I want to share an idea, but what's that plan? And then the next thing is to start writing. And people will say to me, oh, well, I'm not a writer. Everybody's a writer. Mm-hmm. Everybody's a writer. It doesn't have to be a book. It doesn't have to be the greatest novel ever created in life. Mm-hmm. It has to be your story, mm-hmm. and being able to write your story, mm-hmm. and what that story is. Mm-hmm. And then the next one is identifying your audience. Mm-hmm. If your audience is 40 plus, they're going to be on Facebook. Mm-hmm. If your audience are preteens, they're going to be on Snapchat. And like it or not, you're going to have to learn how to use it if that's your audience and if that's the story that you want to tell. And if they're somewhere in the middle there, then Instagram is a great place for storytelling. And Twitter, I like to think of as a global chat room. Mm-hmm. So it's there to use globally, mm-hmm. to get out there to promote things that you want to do. And then after you're identifying your audience, so you have your plan, you are writing your plan, you're listening to your audience, what does your audience want, and then you're using the channels that are appropriate for that particular audience. Mm-hmm. And then you want to schedule your posts. The hardest part about all of this is it's not that it takes a lot of money, but it does take a lot of time, mm-hmm. to figure out when are those posts going to go up. So I often encourage people, if you don't have anyone who's actually going to babysit your channels, don't jump out in that water, because you're going to need somebody to manage and navigate the sea.
Why yeah. is it important when the post might go up?
Well, a couple of things are going to happen, and I usually say it takes 90 days to figure out where your audience is. Mm-hmm. And you're going to look at some analytics to see when they're online. You want to make sure that you're posting when your particular audience is there, mm-hmm. otherwise it's going to get lost in the noise. Mm-hmm. Particularly in Facebook, it's going to get pushed down in the thread. Mm-hmm. So you want to know what type of day they're on, you want to know when the women are on, when the men are on, you want to know your demographics, and you want to know your time of day, mm-hmm. and you want to know when they're using those platforms, so that when you are scheduling things, they're going to hit them at the time when they're going to best be able to see it.
Mm-hmm. It really resonated with you. Mm-hmm. I saw you nod and smile, mm-hmm. when Danielle said, do you tell people you have to write? And then she said, somebody said, well, I'm not really a writer, and she said, everybody is a writer. That resonated with you. Why?
Because everybody does need to write. No matter what field you're going into, you need to have those communication skills. And particularly in my department, we focus on storytelling, so most of the storytelling units are based there. So whether you're writing a script, or whether you're writing an article, or whether you're writing some text that's going to go with a video or something like that, you need to have those skills.
Mm-hmm. We here at WHUT and the Rock Newman Show, we always love to be of great value, mm-hmm. to our audience. I pulled out some of Danielle's points there, so we could try to give to some of my audience what she charges steep dollars for. Now I'm going to try to get some fair value, because you say, you know, sort of the making of a story.
Mm-hmm.
What I'd like for you to do, former New York Times writer, and many other places also.
And editor.
Mm-hmm. And now professor, is if you would share, because mama is sitting out there with daughter, mm-hmm. and or son, who has an idea about being a storyteller, mm-hmm. about being a writer, about communicating to a larger audience. Give me the construct and the fundamentals of storytelling.
Having a good story, and you know, talking to a lot of people.
That has a little bit of importance.
Yeah, that's really important. Also, trying to tell it through the eyes of someone. So you have to bring in real people and tell their story. So I think that's how people engage into, you know, stories a lot more. Mm-hmm. Having an ear for quotes and voice and things like that. Mm-hmm. And making sure you have all the elements there. You have to connect with people, so you have to think about what's going to resonate with someone and why they're going to, you know, play to their emotions and things too, and the what's in it for me. So that's one of the things too, and making it relevant. So, you know, listening, observing your surroundings and thinking about what people are talking about, what people are experiencing. And you can usually come up with stories if you're a filmmaker or if you're doing, you know, articles for broadcast or print or online journalism or something like that. You know, trying to, because sometimes one of the things I think that we do so well is talk about the stories people aren't talking about and making people see those. Because sometimes they don't end up, you know, on the air or in print or online. So we can find those stories and tell our own stories. So I think that's really important too. And people are doing that in social media as well. They just may be smaller, maybe 140 characters. We're telling a lot of things on all the different platforms, whether it's Facebook or Instagram, things that are going on with us personally, things that other people are talking about that we want to share with people. So, you know, there's a little bit of storytelling in a lot of people.
You have been at the university 15 plus years. Do you find a difference in the student that was coming here and applying and enrolling and sitting in your classroom 12 years ago versus the student today?
Yes, I do. I kind of liken it to like a clock where you're kind of going around the clock and we've kind of come full circle in a sense.
Please explain that.
Well, if you look at, like, say, with millennials, just the things that they've experienced and things that we might have experienced, or even some of the students when I first came in. When I started, it was right around 9/11. So we have some students who've experienced more things in the world in terms of terrorism, in terms of the media revolution with the changes in technology, where they're using that more. So it's just a little bit, different in terms of what they've seen and what they're using and how they live things. So some of them don't have landline phones. Some of the students did before. You know, so it's just different in terms of what, how they do what they do and what they've seen, what they know, and what they're interested in.
Danielle, I'm going to ask you the same question a little differently in that you're not in the classroom. But you have clients that come to you. You've been, you know, a TV producer, and as you say, a storyteller for a long time. What do you see different from the inquiries that you receive now versus, what are the changes from now versus 10, 12 years ago?
Video. Video is the biggest changes in being able to tell your story using video. And a lot of companies, corporations and individuals and small businesses don't know what their story is. And they hire someone like me to help them figure out how to tell that story. They have a great brand, they're doing really well, but they don't understand social media or what the use is or why it should be beneficial to them. And they don't know how to translate their product and their story in a way that will resonate to their customers or to their clients, which is really interesting to me that someone could be in business for so long and not know how to tell their story. So thank goodness it keeps me employed. But I think before we looked at press kits and getting a newspaper article in or getting a hit in a magazine, and that was the extent of it. And now you have to tell your story over and over and over and over and over again in a different way every single time. And I'll tell you who's been really good at it, Nabisco. They had this cookie, and it's the same cookie with the two chocolate and the vanilla in the center, and they had to tell the story, and they've done a great job of creating a character out of this cookie and being able to tell this story on Facebook and giving it many lives and many tears just by creating an animated video of their cookie. Formula's still the same, still tastes the same, still an Oreo, right? An Oreo is an Oreo, an Oreo. How do you tell the story of a, what, 100-year-old cookie, right? But so one of the things that I think has changed is the content. And working with people on what kind of content, what kind of photos do you have? What kind of video do you have? What kind of content could you have? What kind of videos could you take? What kind of photos could you take to help tell that story? We've become very, very visual. Now, I don't know if that's a part of the ADHD community and that, you know, ideas are coming so fast. but we've become very visual. And so I think between then and now, being able to storytell visually is only getting better and more complicated, actually, with some of the apps and things that are coming out. You'll see some of the videos using Boomerang, which is a feature of Instagram, where you'll see somebody doing something going like this over and over again. There's an app called Flexel that you can actually pour water, isolate the background. You can get really creative with the kind of videos that you're using now, and that's where we're starting to move in our storytelling.
I think it's an exciting time for young people to be in the media right now, because there are so many tools and things are changing so quickly, and the cycle is 24/7 now, so they're not constricted by that. So one of the things we also encourage them is flexibility, creativity, and being innovative.
How about us baby boomers?
You're my best client.
But we don't know what we're doing.
Yeah.
Well, a lot more people do. So there, you know, more people, even above baby boomers, are using more technology and using more social media. It's still not where it could be. And some of that, you know, may not change eventually. But the numbers are picking up. And people are trying a lot more things.
And so really, a fundamental question is, for those that are watching, that, trust me, I know that there are folks out there that are looking in, feeling lost, and very much behind, just very much behind, questioning whether or not they could ever catch up. So I'm going to ask, again, I'm going to use that term fundamentally, what are some things that they might do? First, Professor Lamb.
Just be comfortable with it, because they're not going to break it. It's not as hard as they think it is. I think a lot of times people have self-imposed barriers because they think it's like something that's really complicated and foreign. It could take baby steps in it. If you think about, like, just think about yourself and how far you've come in over the years. Say, look at the last 5 to 10 years.
And I was also the last hold out on the cell phone. I don't need no cell phone.
And now you probably, like you said, you can't get away from it. But also grab a young person, because, you know, they can show them a lot too quickly in terms, and a lot of people do that already anyway, with showing them how to use their phones, how to use different devices that they have. But they can help them get introduced to different types of social media. Some people start out on Facebook or Twitter or different things like that. Once people start doing it, some of them end up getting hooked. But, you know, in terms of a lot of families are using it to communicate. I know, like, for our family reunion, we use it a lot to communicate with people. And it's helped a great deal. And we could see a shift in, like, some of our older members of the family using it.
I'm a tail end of the baby boomers, so we can't use that as an excuse of not being able to use this technology, because I've self-taught myself how to code and how to do a lot of this. I think the very first thing is being authentic and decide what story you want to tell. What is it that you want to communicate? So if you're a foodie, you might want to start out of just telling stories about food. Take photos of food, put them up on Instagram, see who likes them. And then you want to choose the right platform. I think that Facebook comes easier to some of the boomers because they're already on there doing it socially, and Facebook owns Instagram. Instagram is really easy and simple to use. You can put a photo up, a little quote, a hashtag, and keep it moving. And then finally, you want to think about the length. That length is everything. So it's 140 characters on Twitter. That gets very difficult for some people. I have a client who wants a lot to say, and I'm looking at her going, it's not going to fit in the tweet. We've got to be able to edit that down. It's very difficult for some people who are great storytellers, right? No, we can't do it in 4 tweets. We're going to have to get to the meat of it. I think that that length, though, helps people narrow focus in terms of what they want to say. You can speak a little bit longer on Facebook. You can have a little bit longer conversation on Instagram. Visuals are going to be the key. Then you want to know your audience. So if you're doing a foodie blog, or if you're going to do a foodie photos, you certainly want to be tagging your friends that like food. Don't tag grandma who could care less about what you're posting on Instagram. So you want to make sure that you're reaching out to the right people. And then you want to engage your audience. One of the things I think that people forget is that it's called social media. And the great depth of it is the social part of it. So you can't just put a blog post up, or put an Instagram photo up, or place something on Facebook and then walk away and think that that's the end of it. You want to be there to ask a question. That's a great way to get people engaged. I tried this new restaurant. Here's the food. I keep going back to food. Maybe I'm hungry. I tried a new restaurant. Here's the food that I posted. What do you think about? To get your audience engaged, asking questions is a great way to get them involved. And I think one of the things that she said earlier, which I tell people all the time, including my family members, you're not going to break the internet.
Yeah.
You're not going to break your phone. Yeah, yeah. You're not going to break Facebook. It's going to be okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let me ask you, as someone who's the chair of a communications department, about First Amendment. Facebook, you see these videos of the most horrible activities. Children getting knocked out, someone committing suicide, stabbings, and the rest. You know, if you can talk to us about what you think is a Facebook's responsibility for the content that it allows. And I know that that is a tightrope, because on the one hand, you know, we want to fight for free speech. On the other hand, the public good or the public damage, you know, how do we factor that into what is the Facebook's responsibility?
It is a fine line, but I think just like with anything that, you know, we have to speak up about things that we like and we don't like, and, you know, whether it's Facebook or another platform, to pressure them to take it off if it should be taken off, or sometimes the self-policing. There's a woman named Michelle Ferrier. She started a site called Trollbusters that's kind of looking at messages that basically online harassment of women and of African Americans. And so a lot of times they call it out, or they kind of form a protective shield around some of the people who are being targeted on there too. So the people are looking for it a lot and trying to monitor it a little bit more. There's another woman named Anita Samuels who did a book called Rants and Retorts, and she was looking at comments in social media. And it started looking at some of the comments that were being made when Obama was in office. But she started looking at a lot of it in a lot of different areas affecting African Americans. So it is a fine line, because we do want to tell those stories, and it's another way for us to get out messages, particularly stories that aren't being told, or to share information that maybe somebody didn't see, or to correct it too, because sometimes we have to correct different things that's out there when there's misinformation, and a lot of that is there. And that's another reason we were talking about having parents involved too, so that they're filtering those messages for their children, so they can see. One of the first courses we teach is a digital media literacy course, which is required of all the students in the School of Communications, so they understand what's real
digital
and what's not.
Digital media literacy.
Yes, in the Kathy Hughes School of Communications. But so that they understand what's real and what's not, and understand fake news. And we also have a new fact-checking site called truthbetold.news, where we look at stereotypes, myths, and false statements about African Americans. And, you know, they look at some fun stuff too, but kind of set the record straight on those things and kind of break it down and see, you know, what's true and what isn't and why.
Do you guys have any particular insight as to sort of the next big thing in social media? What's on the horizon?
I think the next big thing is going to be how we're using visuals, and that it's going to become a lot more...
Visuals as just a photo or action?
Video.
The combination of how do you take a still and make a still move. The things that, again, that they're doing with Flexel and some of these other apps, of being able to isolate portions of a photo and changing the background. And we're going to get really creative about some of the things that we're going to be able to do visually and how we're going to tell those stories. Big brands are already using them. And it's going to start to trickle down now to us now that the brands are using them. Facebook is rolling out for businesses a video cover. So you'll have your profile, and then you'll have a video cover behind it. Once the businesses grab onto that, then it's going to trickle down to the rest of us. And then that's going to translate over to Instagram, and then it's going to go over to Snapchat. So it's these being able to tell these quick stories in visually compelling ways are going to be the wave of the future. And I'm hoping that big content that happens in newspapers are still going to be the wave of the future as well, because as we've seen, we need the long, in-depth storytelling in addition to some of the quick content that we're going to see developing.
And I agree with that, like more with visuals, whether it's still images or video images, more with animation, and then using it for different story forms. I mean, you're seeing a lot of people use it for poetry, for narrative stories, for fiction, for movies, for short little stories and things too.
We have a minute left. I'm gonna ask you, the professor, is television going to survive?
Everything is in a different form. I think with the technology, it's disrupted everything. So I'd like to see television survive. Everything's going to be different. But I think that the challenge that, you know, as we've seen so far, is for different companies to kind of to look forward and be innovative and think ahead and kind of innovate with the times, too, so that things can survive. But in look at the habits as they change, because a lot of viewing habits have changed, for particularly for younger people. So looking at the next audience.
Mm-hmm. 30 seconds.
Television is absolutely going to survive. It's just going to survive on a smaller screen. And for those in our community, it's a great time for storytelling and to be able to tell our story in a way that has not been provided to us from the larger screens. So it's a great time for African Americans and all minorities to be able to get out there and tell their story.
Man, this hour has gone by extraordinarily quickly. You've really filled us with a bunch of information. I'm glad you were able to make it here. We attempt, as I said earlier, from this desk, to have an impact on the narrative. And the information that you all have provided us gives us some of the tools to do that. So from the bottom of my heart, thank you both so much for being our guests today.
Thank you
for having us.
Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye and God bless.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.